Just ahead on Tempo in Depth, are you ready to retire? I guess a better question might be, can you afford to retire? According to a national survey, more than a quarter, 27% of workers say they're not at all confident about retirement. Tonight, we'll show you a tale of two retirements, one couple enjoying their golden years and another a little anxious about theirs. We'll have some expert advice and tips to help you make some smart choices on the issue. Don't go anywhere. The conversation starts right now. Good evening. Thanks so much for joining us. I'm Amy Burkett. We're glad to see you this evening and glad to welcome another studio audience. But it's time now to get started, and we're going to get the bad news out of the way first. According to the national research, some research done by an employee benefit company, a third of all Americans say they had to tap into an IRA, a 401k, or other investment accounts in order to just pay for basic expenses right now. Now, that causes a lot of trouble later, and that makes realizing their retirement dreams even more difficult. Whatever you picture, it'll take a lot of planning and probably some sacrifice to achieve your retirement dreams. Tempo in Depth's Laura McHugh introduces us to one local couple living it up in retirement and shares expert advice on how you can, too.
There is nothing like a dream, nothing in the world.
The songs of South Pacific transport John and Kit Cotton from their Bethlehem living room right back to the region where they met more than 40 years ago.
I had just graduated from college. The year was 1969. Look at that.
In a love story for the ages, John, an Air Force fighter pilot, and Kit, a donut dolly entertaining the troops for the Red Cross, met and fell in love in the middle of Vietnam.
My first assignment was at an Air Force base called Thuy Hoa, and John was a fighter pilot there, and I was playing the piano in the officers' club.
There was a pretty young donut dolly that was up on stage playing the piano, and she was playing some beautiful classical things, and I thought, oh, isn't this nice, you know?
I was feeling a little melancholy, and there was one man in a green flight suit sitting there listening, and that turned out to be John.
A year later, we left together as husband and wife, and we've been a great team ever since.
The Cottons traveled with the military, raised three kids, and settled in Bethlehem after John retired from the Air Force. He continued flying as a commercial pilot and stopped working for good about 10 years ago.
I believe that a person should retire early and often.
Today, the Cottons spend almost every waking minute of retirement together. They still love to perform and sing at local retirement communities.
There, that'll keep that good and hot.
Several times a month, they volunteer for Meals on Wheels. After picking up the food, John drives, and Kit usually hand-delivers the freshly cooked meals.
Hi, Frank. Meals on Wheels.
Then they travel. Using free passes from the military and the airline where John worked, the Cottons floated down a river on a houseboat in France and spent 3 weeks touring New Zealand.
This is joyful noise. Goes puckety, puckety, puckety.
When they're not jet-setting around the globe, John and Kit climb aboard their motorhome.
The name of the Winnebago is Joyful Noise, and that's because when we start it up and you hear the puckety-puckety-puck, it's a joyful noise to our ears because we know we are going to set off on another adventure together.
Going on 30 this year, well, it's time for me to start getting serious about thinking about my retirement. And while I hope it looks a little less like this, and a little more like the Cottons. Now this is more like it. My husband and I have often dreamt of seeing the country via motorhome when we retire, but how can we make it happen?
The Cottons live on John's military retirement and supplement their income with his airline retirement, Social Security, and a couple of small investment portfolios. But younger generations can't necessarily count on employer and government-sponsored programs. Financial planner Bob Brown of Lehigh Valley Investment Group says if there's one piece of advice he can share, it's the value of planning.
So I think it's important for them to plan this out ahead of time and know what they want to do and put into motion all the things that they need to do, financial and otherwise, to make sure that they have the time and the money and the health to do the things that they want to do.
People live longer now and should plan for 20 to 30 years of retirement, Bob says. While the steps to the retirement of your dreams are simple, Bob admits following those steps is really difficult, and it helps to start early.
When you're in your 20s, pay yourself first. So think about taking 10% of your income, no matter what it is, and setting that aside first into a retirement program.
Bob recommends using a 401k, 403b, or an IRA for these long-term investments. Then he advises clients to set aside an emergency fund of at least 6 months of take-home pay, maybe more.
These are rainy day funds that would go into a bank account or a money market, something like that, that allows you to continue to enjoy life and weather storms as they come up without having to dip into your retirement.
Models for many, John and Kit have gracefully dipped into their own retirement years, and Kit says they prepared more than their finances.
Keep the relationship between yourself and your spouse alive through all the working years, because then you have something to fall back on when you are retired. You recall good times together, but you've built a good foundation on which to do everything else that you want to do.
After four decades, John and Kit still hold on to the sense of adventure that drew them to one another. For Tempo in Depth, I'm Laura McHugh reporting.
Thanks so much, Laura. We're so excited that joining us in the studio audience today are Kit and John Cotton. They're there. I love them to death. They happen to be my neighbors, I'll admit to it. And Bob Brown, who you saw in that package as well, was in the front row. So now we need more questions. So to answer those questions, I have a special guest joining me in the audience. It's Mary Evans. She's with Evans Wealth Strategies. Mary, we appreciate your time and can't wait to hear about your advice.
Oh, well, thanks for inviting me. I'm so happy to be here, Amy.
You know, it's a crazy time, and everyone wants to invest, and a lot of people have 401ks and IRAs, but we've seen the stock market just be a crazy roller coaster, and sometimes I'm afraid as I get older, my fear factor is much lower than it was when I was younger. What kind of advice, you know, some people just want to pull the money out and stuff it under the mattress or under their pillow. Not a good idea, I suspect?
Not a good idea, because unfortunately, if it's under the pillow, you're not going to earn enough even to keep up with inflation, let alone create the funds that you need to retire. I think one of the most valuable things that you can do is really learn how the stock market works and the difference between volatility and a loss. Sir John Templeton, one of the great investors, his advice was the success to investing is not to get scared out of it. Mm. And I know one of the keys I tell my clients all the time is that the stock market drops an average of 30% once every 4 years, and yet it just continues to grow and grow and grow.
Well, there are those people who watch the income statements every month and see it be that little roller coaster goes down. I guess it's just a paper loss for now. I mean, as long as I'm not ready to take it out yet, a little dip along the way isn't too difficult? You say we have short-term memories as Americans, that we don't remember the bad times of the past, because these last 4 years seem pretty tough.
These last 4 years have been very, very difficult. I kid around that I have two types of clients during that time period, those that were afraid and those that were lying to me about being afraid. But since World War II, we have had 13 bear markets. This was a particularly difficult one. But a high-quality, well-balanced portfolio has never gone down and stayed down. Never. And so if we can just adjust to that, and one of the ways that you adjust is never invest money that's for the short term. So one of my rules is if you think you're going to need this money over the next 2 years, do not invest it in the stock market. You can put it in money markets or CDs or, you know, something very safe where the principal will not fluctuate. But really investing in the stock market with that volatility, that's for long term, not short term.
What else? You have some five key risks for retirement. You talk about longevity, healthcare expenses, inflation, asset allocation, and excess withdrawal. Let's start with longevity.
Okay. Well, I think one of the things that people miss planning for is they tend to think about their average lifespan, sometimes based on those actuarial tables. But if an average lifespan is 78, that means 50% of people are going to live beyond that. And one of the statistics is if you have a couple today, age, they're both 65, and they're both healthy, there's a 50% chance that one of them will live past 90, and there's a 25% chance that one of them will live past 97. So when you go to invest, you don't think about saving money till you're age 65. You have to think about saving money till you're 95. So that money needs to work for you for 30 more years.
You've scared me even more. I'm going to be 95 before I get to retire, Mary. You know, you often say, everyone talks about being afraid, will Social Security be there for me? But you say it's not necessarily Social Security that you're concerned about. You're worried about those health care costs.
Absolutely. Social Security is a fixable situation. There's no doubt that it is having trouble. But there are about 8 or 9 proposals in Congress right now, although we know how our congressmen don't necessarily get along. But these fixes would fix it for about 75 years. So probably everyone that we're talking to, it would cover them. Each one of these fixes has pluses and minuses to them. Some of them might be extending the amount that one pays Social Security tax on. Right now it maxes out at about $106,000, so it might be extending that. It might be raising it a little bit. There is some talk about possibly cutting benefits slightly, you know, about 8% to those who haven't retired, moving the retirement age out. But all those, or a combination of all those, will actually make Social Security much more viable into the future. But health care cost, Medicare's on fire. That's really where the issues are. And people don't realize that. Even when you're covered by Medicare, that only covers about half of your medical expenses, even above and beyond long-term care. They just completed a study that, as of 2010, that they feel the couple retiring today at age 65 will spend approximately $250,000 to $420,000 on health care costs above and beyond long-term care.
That's not fun. I want to spend it traveling like the Cottons. Yes. I don't want to spend it on those not fun things. And it's hard to even think about that because, like you say, when people talk about saving for retirement, they're saving for that mobile home or that villa in Spain or whatever their favorite dream is. They aren't saying, gee, I want to save to be able to pay my health care costs.
Yeah, absolutely. It does make it a lot more difficult. But, you know, as you deal with older clients and you see what they're going through, anybody who's dealt with an aging parent who's running into those health care costs, it's going to be a lot easier for them to save. You know, one of the things I just dealt with a couple weeks ago, my mother-in-law turned 90, and I went out to Pekin, Illinois, which is where she lived, and I had to put her on hospice. And she would have qualified for Medicare to pay for a nursing home, but when you're on hospice, that stops. So in order to get her into a facility that we thought acceptable because we could not get her back here due to her health, that's costing us $6,000 a month.
Ouch.
Ouch. That's just for the room and board. Medicare does pay for the hospice expenses, but not for the room and board.
What else do we need to know, Mary, in a very short amount of time?
About health care, about retiring?
About retiring.
You have to start saving absolutely right away.
Today.
And one of the things you have to do, you have to have a plan. You can't hit a target you don't have. As I like to say, if you're going to build a house, you wouldn't just start throwing wood together. You would have a plan. So get a plan.
Well, we'll talk more about that plan, so hold tight. We'll be back with you in just a minute. Mary Evans from Evans Wealth Strategies. Well, the first wave of this country's 75 million baby boomers turns 65 this year. That makes them eligible for retirement with Social Security and Medicare. But those two programs alone won't be enough, on average, to cover the costs of living past or even up to the average lifespan of about 78 years old, as Mary just told us. For many baby boomers, retirement at 65 may not be an option. They may have to work into their late 60s or mid-70s to maintain their income and even qualify for more from Social Security. Tempo & Depth's Grover Silcox visits with one couple, both in their late 50s, who live a solid middle-class life in Levittown. They don't know if retirement is in the cards for them. Grover hooks them up with a financial advisor to see if they can find an ace in the hole.
Do you have to settle for the hand you were dealt when planning for retirement?
Given my situation, I don't believe I'm getting a wild card. It's going to take a serious readjustment for me personally to be able to see when I can retire.
You know, I think I have to work longer than what I had originally planned.
Jim and Bonnie McGoldrick must deal with the challenges faced by most baby boomers these days. They fear that their retirement dreams might not stack up against the hard numbers. Like so many other middle-income Americans in this tough economy, they're struggling just to stay in the game. Jim speaks about his own situation as a tax technician for the IRS.
My salary's already been frozen for 2 years. It's going to be frozen for another three. They can freeze your salaries. The bills don't get frozen.
Bonnie serves as an executive administrative assistant for an employee benefits consulting firm. She hopes to keep working there till she retires. However, she experienced employee layoffs at another company in the past, which impacted her ability to retire with confidence.
And I've been through two different employers since then. So now I'm not really sure when I can retire.
Bonnie and Jim, now in their late 50s, know that it's time to lay their cards on the table and take a cold, hard look at where they stand financially. To plan for a retirement that could last 30 years or more. It has for Bonnie's mother, who's still fit and active at 90 years old. So planning is a must. At our request, the McGoldricks sat down with Russ Talone, a certified financial planner from Montgomery County.
I think the biggest fear is being told that when he looks at all the numbers and crunches them all, he'll look you in the eye, if he's honest, and tell you that you're never going to be able to retire.
Rarely is there nothing someone can do to improve their situation. If you know you're going to run out of money at age 70, if we can make small changes now that might project that to age 75 or age 77, that's a huge difference potentially.
Bonnie and Jim see retirement as a way of spending more time doing what they love.
We have two grandchildren and one on the way, and we'd like to be able to enjoy them and be able to spend more time with them.
If we wake up someday when we're retired and we want to go camping, just hook up the camper and go. But we also want to have the freedom to stay here, be with our grandchildren.
So how do they make the most of the hand they've got?
We're basically going to build a balance sheet and an income statement for them. We're just going to inventory all their assets, future cash flows, any liabilities they have, car loans, credit cards, mortgages. We want to look at Social Security statements. We'll review their current insurance coverages. So the five things we want to talk about tonight are going to stress test your ability to have a successful retirement.
From information gleaned from a pre-meeting questionnaire and his own in-person fact-finding, Russ discovers that the couple may have some aces in the hole. For one, both Bonnie and Jim have pension plans.
They've got a lot of tools at their disposal as far as pension income they can rely on, which a lot of folks don't have.
And they have their house. Like many people, they count the house as their biggest asset.
I've been here over 20 years, not quite 30.
The good news is that now the home is worth more than she owes.
They didn't get swooped up into the 2006 home appreciation and subsequent depreciation that a lot of folks are going through now.
The couple also have Social Security, a couple CDs, and 401ks to bank on. What they need now is a more defined budget so they know where to reduce debt going forward.
I think going through a budget will be a good process for them, and so far they seem very open to it.
Bonnie and Jim found this initial step reassuring.
It's forced me to take a look at what I have and what I don't have, and maybe I do feel a little bit better right now.
Once we inventory their assets, their income streams, and we capitalize those values to present, as well as their expected outlays and expenses, we will come up with here is your gap in today's dollars and exactly what you need to do between now and our X date to close that gap.
They may choose to retire later than sooner, get a part-time job after retirement, but at least they'll know what their options are.
But every situation is unique, and they've got things in their favor that we can leverage, and they have challenges that we'll have to focus on.
It's a challenge Bonnie and Jim and millions of people like them know they must face, because the stakes are too high to simply fold and walk away. For Tempo In Depth, I'm Grover Silcox reporting.
Thanks so much, Grover. Joining me again is Mary from Evans Wealth Strategies. Mary, we appreciate your time. You know, we saw something in that story from Grover's that you and I have talked about before. A lot of people are retiring and not just relying on Social Security. They have they have to work part-time jobs. And that's something are you seeing that more and more, that people after they retire are still doing a little bit of work?
Absolutely. That's one of the main things that I recommend, that oftentimes it's not that people don't want to work anymore. They might not want their high-stress corporate job. So I recommend they find a job that's maybe less hours, less stress, and that they can do for maybe another 10 years. That dramatically changes the retirement plan, and it really helps them make it through retirement.
So I had a realization this week as I was preparing for the show. I went online to the Social Security Administration website, just had a birthday recently, and kind of ran the numbers on what I can expect from Social Security, and I'm going to work forever. I mean, that's what I'm pretty much convinced about. You know, but help people understand, you receive less if you retire at 62. I'm looking at a difference of about $1,300 if I could work all the way to 70 in my monthly takeout from Social Security. $1,300 a month is a big difference.
It's an enormous difference. And there's just a study that came out that said if you can defer Social Security, do so. There are three dates. The date you can first start to retire, which is age 62. For people in their 50s, their full retirement age, which is around 66 and 67. So if you start collecting at 62 versus 66, you'll get about 25% less. If you do start collecting at your full retirement age, by the way, you can work an unlimited amount of dollars and not have that reduced. But if you choose to wait to your 70, each year from your full retirement age to age 70, you'll get about a 7 or 8% increase in your Social Security for each year. So that's a really nice bump if you can do it.
Big numbers, big numbers.
Big numbers.
Now we want to take a question from our audience. We've got John from Plainfield Township. John, go ahead with your question.
Thank you very much. I will be reaching the age in a few years where it will be mandatory that I take money out of my IRA account. My question to you is, what will my options be, do I have any options?
Options. We love options.
We do love options, but now we're dealing with the IRS, so we do have limited options. When you put your money in that IRA, you didn't pay taxes on it. And the reason that you have to start taking money out at age 70 and a half is that the IRS wants to start collecting taxes on it. So you do need to take it out. It tends to be about 4% of your balance. It's a mathematical calculation that's driven by the government. So you do need to take that out of your IRA. You will need to pay tax on the amount that you take out of the IRA, but it doesn't mean you have to spend it either. You know, you can just continue to invest it in a taxable account and keep that for some of your later years.
I've got another question, this one from a Shire audience member who wrote it down but wants me to say it instead of asking it herself. It's Sharon from Bethlehem, and she wants to know, how do you save for retirement when you're just a one-income family? We see so many two-income families these days to try and make ends meet, let alone save for retirement. It has to be even more difficult when you have just one income.
Yeah, it is very difficult today. You know, the joke is that, you know, two people live as cheaply as one used to. But whether you're one-income family or two-income family, you pay your electric bill, you pay your mortgage, you pay your cable, you have to pay your retirement bill. When we've gone from pensions to 401k, it really is your responsibility. One of the things that I tell people is just start. Start, make it automatic. Of course, if the one person has matching on a 401k in the company, you really need to put away the extent that they're matching.
Because why give away free money?
Exactly. That is free money, and you're never going to do any better than that. But another thing that you can do is each year, as that wage earner gets a raise, nobody wants to give away all their raise. You've worked so hard all year to get that. But what if you said, we'll spend 50% of that raise, and we'll take another 50%, and we'll make that additional savings for retirement. Do that each year, and it's going to make an enormous difference.
And doesn't hurt quite as much. I've got one more question from the studio audience, Mary. This one's from Bob in Fogelsville. Bob, go ahead with your question.
Yes, I recently experienced a death in my family, and my question is, what is the percentage of inheritance tax, and does that percentage vary depending on the relationship to the deceased?
No one wants to pay an inheritance tax.
Nobody wants to pay any taxes. They particularly don't want to pay an inheritance tax, which we refer to as the death tax. Well, there's a difference of whether we're talking federal or state. The federal, right now, there's an exclusion of $5 million. So unless you're receiving more than $5 million, there will not be a federal inheritance tax. If it goes above $5 million, it will be at 46%. That is the rules so far for this year and next year. I don't know what's going to happen after that. In the state of Pennsylvania, there is an inheritance tax, and that tax changes based on the relationship that you have with the deceased.
In less than a few seconds, so is the key, if you have a loved one who's doing better, do you get it all over before they die? Is this, if they get ill, do you want to get it to your name so you don't have, I mean, is there a way around this?
Well, there is no inheritance tax between husband and wife. So if you have those two, it's fine. And really, unless you're talking greater than $5 million, for federal, it's not a problem. Pennsylvania tax is fairly low. It's about 4%. But they can start to gift to their children $13,000 a year, or to anyone, a little over $13,000
a year. Great information. Mary Evans from Evans Wealth Strategies. We're so grateful for your time and your information. We could talk all day about this. But don't go anywhere. I've got one more little task for you to do, okay?
All right.
Well, finally tonight, here are a couple of great resources for you. The Social Security Administration offers a retirement calculator that estimates how much money you can expect monthly based on when you retire and how much you've paid in. That's what I was referring to. I checked out. Scared me to death. Head to ssa.gov/retirement. And also, the nonprofit AARP has dozens of articles about money, work, and retirement on their website at aarp.org. Now, we love to have your feedback. So please friend us on Facebook and let us know what you thought about tonight's show and give us your questions for the next one. I'd like to thank our studio audience for joining us tonight. They're a great group, and I'm so grateful. There's friends from the Bethlehem Township Bulldogs, parents and grandparents there, and each person has a goodie bag with some yummy snacks from our friends at Just Born. The Sands Casino Resort Bethlehem has a voucher for a discount on food, plus we have a prevention magazine from our friends at Rodale, and some other discounts and resources are in there as well. But I've saved the best for last. Everyone in the audience was given a number when they came in, and I have a special drawing right now, a couple of them to be exact. First, we have two tickets to see Bill Haley's Comets at the State Theater in Easton on November 19th, and this is Mary's job to draw me out a good name.
All right, this is the fun part. There you go.
We've got numbers. Let's see right here. We've got number 15. If number 15 in the audience would stand up. Oh, we have a winner. Very good. Very good. Okay, I've got another. Next, I have dinner or lunch from Emerald's Italian Table, valued at $50. Mary, give me one more name.
I hope whoever gets it's going to take me with them.
You know, it never seems to work that way.
Yeah.
19, number 19. We have, yes. Okay, finally tonight, our good friends at Zollner Arts Center at Lehigh University have donated a family four-pack to see the Nutcracker coming up on December. Now, that's a $72 value. This is your last job of the night, Mary.
Okay, here we go. There you are.
The last lucky winner for this evening is number 10. Number 10. Oh, there we go. Well, that does it for Tempo tonight. Thanks so much for joining us, and we hope to see you in our audience sometime soon. Good night. Like to be part of a studio audience for a live taping of Tempo in Depth. Join us at the PBS 39 Public Media and Education Center on the Steel Stacks campus in Bethlehem. For free tickets and information, 610-867-4677 extension 333, or go online to tempo.wlvt.org. I hope to see you soon.